for Design Recipes is provided by Trunk Club, making sense of style. On this episode of Design Recipes, the best of the best. Design ideas from some of New York City's top designers as they pull out all the stops for the first ever Brooklyn Heights Designer Showhouse. Our Brooklyn expert, Donald Brennan, takes us there. It all starts right now with Donald Brennan in Brooklyn Heights. Hi, Donald.
Thanks, Kathy. Brooklyn Heights is one of the most historically significant areas of Brooklyn. Many of its brownstones predate the Civil War and are protected in large part thanks to the watchful eye of preservationists. This year, for the first time, a designer showhouse that not only highlights the work of noted New York designers, but gives the public a rare look inside one of these historic homes. Nestled among the tree-lined streets that Brooklyn Heights is known for sits 32 Livingston Street, a historic brownstone built shortly after the Civil War. It's a stunning example of Neo-Grec style brownstone. 32 Livingston has been privately owned by the same family since 1960. And this year, the owners opened their doors for the first ever Brooklyn Heights Designer Showhouse. 16 notable designers were given the ambitious task of creating a one-of-a-kind showhouse, blending historic architecture and modern design. Each space throughout the showhouse is an example of each individual designer's vision and creativity. To learn more about how this spectacular showhouse came together, I had the honor of interviewing some of the designers. Hi, Glenn, how are you?
Hey, Donald. Good to see you.
Good to see you. So I understand you're a resident of the neighborhood. How, if any way, did that inform you in some of the decisions you made here?
Well, part of the reason I moved to Brooklyn Heights was because of the historic architecture. Mm-hmm. And working with this room, which is a magnificent 19th century room, it informed everything.
Sure. Understandable. And the location in the home, being the living room near the entry, how did that come into play for you?
Well, my philosophy around interior design is that rooms should greet you when you enter.
Right.
In the same way that when you see someone on the street, you open your arms.
Sure.
And so what I tried to do with this room is that when you come into the house, the big double doors there invite you into the room.
Right, good, makes a lot of sense. Anything else unique about the space that caused you to make a decision that maybe you might not see in another brownstone with a similar configuration?
Well, this is a 25-foot wide house, so it's got a particularly wide living room,
right.
And it's got remarkable proportions. Mm-hmm. It's 31 feet long, which is a challenge, and one
right.
of the challenges with brownstones is that you either center furniture around the fireplace, or you end up with two seating groups at opposite ends of the room.
Uh-huh.
And in this case, what I tried to do was sort of bring the seating area over, into a broader area and create a multi-purpose area at the other end.
Yeah, I think it works fantastic. What a great job.
Thank you.
Adjacent to the living room is the equally impressive dining area, created by a design team from Deborah Burke Partners. Hi, Kiki.
Hi, Donald.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Very well, very well. So this space is typically used as a formal dining room in most brownstones. You've decided to do something a little different. Can you talk about your design philosophy, about your decisions here?
Sure. We were really excited to get the dining room, but we wanted to approach it in a little different way.
Mm-hmm.
We wanted to make a space that would really work for today's lifestyle.
Sure.
And that would be more multi-purpose. I think, you know, a dining room space can often become the room that you never go into unless there's a formal occasion. And we felt like it was more important to create a space that could be used all throughout the day, from morning coffee to afternoon to evening cocktails. And we love the adjacency to the kitchen and the gardens in this particular space, and really imagined the people who would be using it kind of circulating throughout the space and having a variety of kind of activities and social kind of parties and various occasions where they could get together in the space.
Yeah, very interesting. So one of the elements that jumped out at me when I first saw the room was the lighting. It is really interesting and dynamic. Can you talk a little bit about that?
This is an element we were really excited about. We were able to collaborate with a company called Bone Simple to design this custom fixture that was made for the space.
Right.
It's handmade. It incorporates string and macrame and hand-dyed elements to create, I think, a chandelier that's really dynamic. It solves the lighting problems in a space that you have like that, in this, and that you can have the pendants at different heights and different points to really light the room holistically without resorting to punching holes in this beautiful historic ceiling.
Sure, yeah. Very visually interesting and extremely functional, especially with the adaptability.
Absolutely. And I think very dramatic and very appropriate for a space that we hope will be used for entertaining and also kind of create an intimate, cozy scene for every day as well.
Yeah. Extremely well done. Nice job.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Boasting an impressive four floors, the top floor could have been a discarded space, but it is made useful as an expansive family room.
Hi, Jennifer. How are you?
Hi, Don.
So, can you tell us a little bit about the space before you even started your work in here? What did that look like?
I can. This space was a largely forgotten space in the house. It was as light as this room is, it was dark. The walls were painted varying shades of turquoise and black, and the floors were burgundy and black, and things were just in poor repair in general.
Yeah.
And then there was, most importantly, there was a big sauna right here where we're standing right now, and it was a storage room.
Right, sure. So your vision for the space, what was your philosophy behind the design decisions here?
Well, I think this entire house is a very grand, formal house. I would say it was like putting a puzzle together. It was mostly a pragmatic decision because the walls were in really terrible shape and the ceiling was also in terrible shape. So I needed to figure out a way to like build a shell.
Right.
And beadboard was a material that was gonna work well. And sort of from there, then it all happened at the same time. I wanted a light, bright, airy room.
Right. And the function of it, you know, this is a pretty big house that we're in here. Do you envision this being used as it's been designed?
Absolutely. I tried to create a space that I actually would want to spend time in. Mm-hmm. Initially, everybody kept suggesting I build a playroom.
Right.
And I have enough playrooms in my life. So I thought that this would be a nice opportunity just to have a very casual sort of unprogrammed space where you could relax or be creative or really do anything you want.
Yeah, it looks fantastic. You guys did a lovely job.
Thank you so much.
And as you can see, some of the most noted creative minds creating a one-of-a-kind, first-of-its-kind Brooklyn Heights designer show house. If you have the chance to take a tour, you'll find you have the opportunity to see historic architecture and cutting-edge design. I'm Donald Brennan of Brennan Real Estate. I'm going in to take another look.
Thanks for watching. You can watch episodes anytime at pix11.com/designrecipes. See you next time.